Has momentarily covered Bob Marley's life. His spirit and his music, however, shall multiply more than ever, and his name perpetuated in memory. For the consciousness of a global audience has been arrested by the pungency of his lyrics, Bob Marley's Power Realm. Master of reggae, the man who fashioned an indigenous form into an international language, and in the process made himself the most famous Jamaican of the 20th century, surpassing his mentor Marcus Garvey, with whom he shares the same birthplace, St. Anne.
Thank you.
After leaving the hills of St. Anne, he lived in no less than four ghettos, and out of that crucible, his sensibilities crafted songs of the poor, as he lived as part poet, mystic, rebel, and prophet. From 1972, his rise was dramatic, and his prolific output of music, some 400 songs, it is said, has made him one of the giants of pop music, and an innovator in the areas of the popular song and live performance.
Sometimes I go, realize everything was nice. You know, when we was a little child. He used to love everybody, and Marcia was nice, and Miller, and then we go and go and go and come to realize it. Like, he's still here at night. You know? But I was scared to see that. He said, you know, he started me to come up to see. He started finding guy that started, you started finding guy that started me back. You know, same things happen. And it's all caused from the poverty of the people living up. And someone can't think good about someone because they're teaching us. And then the poverty, you know, to do everything. Man, get a bank and I didn't wear some feet, guys. If I'm going to sit there and think over and talk funny, you know, want freedom, you know, want to live good as the rest of you. Mm-hmm. Want righteousness, want freedom, you know, want plenty of things. Make life better, you know, as the rest of you.
Some of them can't believe that this can really happen. Without you put things in there to kick it up together and make it feel like this. Now just go. Natural. If I should have put wax in this to keep it so, then I wouldn't do it. You know? If it can't be one of them things that come natural, then you take no time. I mean, not that. But you know, plenty of people have no wrong idea about this. You can just imagine if everyone from the earth did have up there now. What would I look alike and no one would have run down the thing with them and run down. Man, I like get up and them go, look, and them get cut and and I'm gonna still look like 14. You know, friend, when my home will pop bomb for anything, you know what I mean?
What do you feel about me? Woman.
Woman and mother are creation. You know, what do you want me to feel about woman? Nothing new with a woman creation. I like it, but it's different to me, you know. But me, that's all because of a woman. Man created my own sentiment, man.
Do you have a queen?
You have one queen, no more than one queen.
You feel entitled to more than one queen?
Yeah, I feel entitled to all queens.
Oh, you know how many?
I don't know how many that is, but yeah.
All at the same time?
At the same time? Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, time is time, you know. Time is time. I get my sister, I'm nice, you know. Nice to have somebody you can talk to.
Is it possible that you are, you know, that you're controlled by your queen?
Hey, tell the man to stop them nice here, sir.
I say, do you feel that you are controlled by...
By the woman?
Mm.
Oh, my God. I control women.
So who controls you then?
Me? Mm-hmm. Come from inspiration and job. You know? Yeah. But a woman can't go to the far except to go by the sun. By the sun.
So she has to relate to you completely, where you don't have to relate to her, is that it?
No, okay, really, it's nice, you know. It's just a overstanding to know the jealousy that we do. Now the thing when we don't respect a woman is that if a woman loves me, then she can't expect one woman to love me. I mean, you don't feel pleased for one woman to love me. That means a shot or something. Well, you don't feel pleased again when one woman loves me and next woman who I love me. And this woman vexed that woman because she wants to love me. And even vexed me, sir. We don't call them thing love, we call them thing fuck me. You know what I'm saying? Weird. Because if a woman loves me, then and someone else loves me, she very loves the person who loves me, sir. If she really loves me, you can't find out. We're gonna eat someone who loves me and you say love me.
But suppose...
Suppose
you love her and somebody else loves her.
If somebody else loves her and she loves someone else...
And she loves you too?
No, she don't want to do that. She don't want to do that.
Why not?
Eh?
But if you're...
A woman can have children, right? And she must know who a child belongs to. And we don't deal with a woman who talk about birth control. So, if a woman loves you, she loves someone else. She is someone else. You don't mix me with someone else. Crazy. You know what I mean? Like that.
And if you really think that is perfectly reasonable and fair and just in your life today?
Maybe to some woman, she's not. But you have woman who come for them purposes.
great future, you can't forget your past. So dry your tears, I say. And no woman will cry. No woman will cry. No woman will cry. No, no woman. No woman will cry. You see, I remember when we used to sit in the government yard in Trench Town and then Georgia would make the fire light as it was, love would burn it through the night. Then we would I'll share with you. For my feet is my only courage. I'm in it, so I've got to push on through. But while I'm gone, hey,
everything is gonna be alright. Well, everything is gonna be alright. Everything is gonna be alright. Everything's 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 gonna be alright.
So woman, don't cry. Oh no, no, don't shed no tears. No, no, woman,
no, woman.
Don't shed no tears. No, no woman.
No woman, no cry.
Exactly when a song like this, No Woman No Cry, really reached you.
Well, yeah, it's one time I got on a sandstone. Yeah.
But when you were
a band called Why? I'm burning in charge of art and singing guitar. I saw like a beauty that cry outside, you know. And like a girl. And the song comes. Yeah. And then. But it's a whole true thing, you know.
I was able to recognize all the qualities and goodness in this man and could have said it to him and expressed myself being among him, working along with him, because he has motivated me so much. And it was it's a great experience having working with him all these years, because he has taught me a lot of things in this business. And I'm happy that he has been an ambassador for Jamaica and he has paved the way for all of us. So I would like to see us carry this work through that he has left behind and do it to our best ability. And For some reason, I honestly believe that his soul has found a resting place. And I'm happy for this, that he's not really gone in the sense as most of us would see it. He's just gone on to another plane to continue a work that he started. Well, I am sad that we won't be seeing him on this earth in the flesh anymore, but we'll still meet in the New Jerusalem one day. And I honestly think again that if Bob was here among his own people, the love and the warmth that they would generate to him, this is all he would need to keep him going. And this is free of cost. No money can buy that. And I'm sorry that the condition did not allow him to be here. But God knows best.
Well, first, I must say that I admire the man first through his music before I met him. And recalling back from 1974, when we started with Not a Dread album, I can remember us going into the studio, you know, with Bob arranging the harmony sections for us, even before we had named ourselves I3s, you know. And we worked on that album and we started to tour with him. Well, I must say that I am really privileged from then on to know that when he started his work, I was there with him. And I've learned a lot from him, most of all timing, because plenty musician does not know the sense to be punctual, to know that you're playing the music. Bob taught me that you're playing the music with time and you have to be on time. A musician must be punctual. While we were on tour, Bob used to be the very first one to be on the bus. And that used to teach us as musicians and everyone to know that if the leader is there first, then we must follow his example. Again, I must say that how I have categorized Bob, along with Malcolm X, Marcus Garvey, and all those great prophets and messengers, he has really taught us his inspiration on disc, because our people, the population, the wide population of the world, the masses rather, it's hard for them to communicate through reading because sometimes of the complexity of words. So I would say in this time the man came with the music that everyone could understand. He communicated with the old, the young, with the little children, and everybody could dance to it and understand the lyrics thereof. And that is why I must say that this man is the greatest ambassador that God has ever set foot on this planet Earth. Well, as Sister Marcia said, that she hopes that Bob in his spiritual realm can look down and to see his words, the foundation that he has set, and that we here can continue on that level and even lift it to a higher standard, because we know once you have a foundation, you can build on that. And we have that foundation. We know Bob is not really dead. Bob is alive, because whenever he plays music, whenever you listen to the lyrics of a song, it brings him alive. So definitely, I must say I give my condolences to the family, especially to Rita, and I pray for strength for her.
I miss a place for I. We got to catch a train, cause there's no other station. Here you're going in the same direction. Yeah, this is Zion Trail is coming now. Zion Trail is coming.
Oh, where? Where there's a will, there's always a way. Where there's a will, there's always a way. Where, yeah. Zion train is, Zion train. Zion train is. Thank you.
Especially when you suffer for the right cause, you know. What most of them really would have loved suffer all the while. Mm. But if you understand, it's two different suffering, you know. I'm like the one who suffer for the right cause.
Nation plot against nation, yeah. Brothers fight against brothers, oh yeah. And all of this. And all of that, you put them together, you don't know what. There is too much trouble, oh no! So much trouble in the world.
He's come a long way from the times when he lived in Ghost Town and sold records in Greenwich Park Road, Beeston Street, and Orange Street. From the days when he was ripped off and samfied. Today he's a superstar, and Tough Gong Records is no longer a ghetto record shop, but a budding business uptown in a 50-year-old mansion where Tough Gong is international.
To get rid of the pollution. But before you check this time, please don't leave it.
Approximately how much of your hard-earned money have you invested to bring Tough Gong International to where it is right now?
You mean, Mr. Yeah. Well, yeah. Well, we invest some money right now, you know.
Would you care to name a figure?
Figure? Well, it's a whole lot of money we really invest tonight, you know. Not really a figure right now, but we invest more than $500,000, you know.
Such an empire that you're building is going to be difficult to manage because you're setting up something new and for yourself. You're also an artist. You have to create, you have to tour. How are you going to divide your already busy time running a record industry as well as being
well,
an artist?
I'm not going to run a record industry, you know. Yeah, a lot of people who can do these things, you know. So then people can do it. You know, we only really, we're still artists, you know. So we don't really, like I try to run a record in industry. It's just the facilities that we really need to really continue the work.
With you. Yeah. Yeah. And through the spirit of the Most High, Imperial Majesty, and Riley Isolati, run white in to leading people of this land to be here to shake hands. Show the people that love and right. Show the people that we're gonna unite. Show the people that we're love and right. Show the people that everything is alright. What you doing? Cause I wanna send the matches right out there. I mean, I'm not so good at talking, but I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Well, I'm trying to say, could we have up here on stage here the presence of Mr. Michael Mann and Mr. Edward Seattle?
From the very start, it was obvious that Bob Marley was something apart, was something special. What first brought him to my attention was his intensity, the extent to which he was completely free of any gimmicks, any stage tricks, but performed with as if he was absolutely lost in what he was doing. In fact, it was amazing. I think there were two occasions when he actually fell off the stage, not in any kind of trick at all, because he just was so lost that he had even lost his bearings in his environment. And this quality of intensity was the first thing that really made me realize that this was a completely extraordinary person.
Did he, sir, as a songwriter, have any effect on you as a politician?
Very definitely. Not in the sense of like forming one's political opinions, because those, you know, were formed from before and by other means. But what Marley did, certainly in my own case, was to heighten one's perceptions. If you look at the whole evolution of his lyric writing, he begun as a clear, direct, uncompromising spokesman for man who gave an account of survival in the ghetto. If you go back to the days of Trenchtown Rock, this is just about the raw courage and nature of survival. And I thought that he wrote and sang with such direct eloquence about the ghetto that it would be a very insensitive person whose perceptions of that whole problem in modern life was not heightened and made far more intense by just being aware of his music. Later on, what interested me in Marley's development was the way in which he never compromised. He never compromised what he believed in. And all that happened was the range of his interests and concern seemed to grow. In the end, he was conscious of the Southern African liberation struggle, the struggle of Zimbabwe, the meaning of worldwide oppression. And it always interested me and never ever surprised me that even when his records must have made him a millionaire, that there was no pandering, no softening of the line, no compromising of this clear, strong vision of injustice and the struggle for justice in the world. This always impressed me profoundly.
As a final recollection, sir, how do you look back on the occasion of the peace concert when he brought together yourself and the then leader of the opposition, Mr. Seaga?
Well, I think that was an important thing. It was an evidence of Marley's concern for the effect just on people of political violence. And it obviously was an evidence of his extraordinary, almost charismatic influence in Jamaican life, that he could make it happen. And this in a sense is all of a piece with what I think was his vision of the world and his concerns. Of course, the other thing that has always interested me is the extent to which he grew as an artist, because there's another stream to his development that I think is very important. I've always thought that one of the ultimate tests of the greatness of an artist is whether they can go beyond protest to compassion. If you are both compassionate and uncompromising in your principles, then you are truly great. And I think that No Woman, No Cry, which must really be one of the greatest ballads of compassion ever written by anybody, is an evidence of the sheer stature of the man as an artist and as a human being.
I just want to shake hands and show the people that we're going to meet them right. We're going to unite. We're going to meet them right. We got to unite. Get.
It's not widely known that you are a very successful producer of not only folk music of Jamaica, but also popular Jamaican music, and a prime mover in the international exposure of one of our first popular forms, the ska, which paved the way for reggae and the emergence of Bob Marley. In that context, how do you perceive Marley as an artist?
Well, Marley as an artist has to be associated with the period during which he performed. He himself excelled because of his maturity, and he helped Jamaican music to mature. Now, I say this relatively speaking. The earliest form of Jamaican popular music rhythms was, as you quite rightly say, the ska. And this was born in the early 60s, and it came out of the Western Kingston area, just as most other popular music rhythms have in the past decade or more. But the ska was a relatively simplistic rhythm, beautiful melodies, the type of lyrics that one finds in most popular music. When the reggae emerged on the scene in the second half of the 60s, Marley was able to transpose it into a mature form of music. The lyrics were no longer just reflective of the usual things that popular music composers reflect on in their compositions. It was the music of a man who was a part of a generation in protest. It was the music of a man who had a message. And while it is true that this message and protest genre that developed was something of a North American phenomenon, long after it ceased there, Bob Marley continued with message music and with protest music right throughout the 70s. Because he was a third world citizen, so to speak, he carried the message and the protest of the third world in his music right throughout the 70s, and therefore was the vocal equivalent of what many conferences have been saying concerning conditions under which people in the third world had to survive and had to struggle. Bob therefore took music out of the level of simply looking at the everyday problems which people often have to face, such as love, problems of survival and other things like that, which often is the basis of composition, and took it into a dimension in his lyrics, framed within the very effective rhythm of the reggae in such a way that it became international music. He internationalized the reggae, which was a Jamaican form of music. In doing so, it is true that the internationalization of the reggae was helped by its forerunner, the ska, which was internationalized when it first came on the scene in the early 60s by the efforts of the then singers, composers, and in my capacity then as Minister of Development. But it never really made the international scene effectively because we were limited in many respects. So what we did was a first step, which had some success, and it opened doors, which when the reggae came along and Bob Marley came along at a later stage, he was able to effectively open on a much wider basis.
Yeah.
brethren, it seems as if Marley's dreams are coming true. Bob is feeling the love of Jah as he invites Prime Minister Michael Manley and the opposition leader Edward Siaga on stage. Tell you that was crucial.
I'm waiting. I'm waiting.
Regards to Bob Marley, that it's important to realize that he is the one who is reggae music. I walk down the streets of Kassar El Kabir in Morocco, and there are Bob Marley banners on the streets, and all the young Moroccan kids, none of whom speak English or Jamaican or have any idea what their words mean, or they all have Kaya in their cassette machines and are all grooving to Bob Marley. And in West Africa, he's a great, great culture hero. In Senegal, you know, in Nigeria, and African musicians like Fela are very heavily influenced by Marley. And so whereas you know, in the States, he might not be getting the same attention that he deserves. He's much more of a planetary figure than any American or UK or any other comparable figure living today. And I think we're at the same period, you know, that jazz musicians were in the 20s, when they were in Louis Armstrong and Sidney Bechet were sitting around together saying, gee, I wonder if this will make it, you know. And obviously 50 years later, these people are gods. Well, 20, 30 years from now, the major reggae stars of today will be seen as these great, great master musicians and pioneers. And whereas the road looks tough right now and everybody's struggling, just a little bit of foresight and vision could show any reggae lover how strong their music is and how strong the culture is behind it. And it's also, it seems interesting to me that this should be happening at a time when Jamaica is in the process of reinventing itself in so many ways.
What make you draw back yard? You know fit draw back yard. Propaganda spreading over my name. Say you wanna bring another life to shame. Oh man, you're just a playing a game. What make you draw back yard? What make you draw back yard? What make you draw back yard? I want to disturb my neighbor, 'cause I'm feeling so right. I want to turn up my disco, show them the full watch tonight. I've been